Hello, and welcome to my shot-by-shot breakdown of the brand new Avengers Infinity War trailer. And you know what? You might want to get a snack, because you're going to be here for a while. We have so much to go over, and I continue to be impressed, or at least hope that I will be impressed, so far so good, with the Russo brothers' ability to balance so many characters. I mean, we're going to start with this fancy new poster, and you can see it's chock full of characters. Although I think, amazingly, everybody's got a good spot. It's like the perfectly positioned class photo. Nobody has to feel like they're in the back, and I'm really impressed with some of the people that they got on there. Also, something else I want to point out, by the way, is that I saw, before we like really get into this, is that I saw a couple of people say, what's with all these jokes in the trailer? This isn't a funny story. Let me tell you a funny story. The time Thanos invaded Earth, tried to kill half of it, and probably killed an Avenger or two. Hilarious. Well, you know what? If Marvel's telling the story, it is going to be funny. And that's one of their strengths. I think that especially the Russo brothers, although they were pretty serious in Winter Soldier. I don't know, though. I do agree that the dramatic lines here are the weakest. Although the Black Order looks pretty cool. We're going to talk about them when we get to them in the trailer. But I would say that the strongest points in this movie are probably going to be the comedic elements and the action sequences. The Russo brothers excel in action sequence. They have promised us an action sequence in this movie that tops the airport battle from Civil War, which was amazing. And I think you can see a little bit of a shot of it towards the end of this trailer. And I love it because it feels so comic booky to me. I think it's great. All right, and also the big winner. Who's the big winner today? Well, it's none other than Tom Holland as Peter Parker. Wow, he and Thanos trended when this Twitter broke, and about, I'd say, 45 minutes later when I was getting ready to start filming this, only Peter Parker was still trending. And so I was a big fan of Tom Holland since I saw him in The Impossible. I was rooting for him to get this role. As I say, some of you wanted Asa Butterfield. What are you, crazy? Tom Holland's perfect casting. He is Peter Parker, just as all these other, I think, cast members are their characters. There's something special about Spider-Man. I can't quite put my finger on it. I'm a Batman person myself. I like the X-Men as well. You know, Tom Holland's managed to capture that magic, and you know, fans really gravitate towards him. You know, maybe it's the everyman appeal that Cap has as well. Interesting. Like, do you think people break down to like a Peter Parker, Steve Rogers type, or like a Tony Stark, Batman type? Right? That's an interesting correlation. I guess Superman would be in the other category as well. Oh, fascinating. All right, so let's look at this poster. I'm so impressed with Robert Downey Jr. He got his way to the center of it once again. Now, as I said, everybody has a good spot, but he has the best spot, especially because his arc reactor calls attention to his face, which is right above it. And I'm also surprised that they allowed him to strike the exact same pose that they did in the Thor Ragnarok posters. But that's working for them. And I would actually say this poster is a mix of Thor Ragnarok and the recent Guardians of the Galaxy poster. And so Kevin Feige said they were headed in that direction. They seem to be headed that direction in every way possible, including poster design. Now, look who's on this. Look at Wong. I can't believe Wong made the poster. That's amazing. Hawkeye's like, my agent sucks. I am not on the poster, but Wong is. I'm also very impressed that both Shuri and Okoye made the poster, and their names are on the top of it, by the way. That's so fabulous. And you know who I think looks really cool? I'm actually becoming a White Wolf fan. That's right. Bucky's new code name, his new made-up name, as Peter Parker would say. Way to really make it seem silly, Peter, right? It's like, those are our code names, thank you very much. Sure, we did make them up, but come on. But I think that ever since Bucky got his Vidal Sassoon hair, I kind of think he's pretty awesome. I think he's going back to like his Winter Soldier greatness from the action sequences in that first movie. I hope that he's really a big factor in the action sequence here. He was so cool in the Winter Soldier. I can't wait to see him hopefully reclaim that. He's feeling a little better about himself. He likes the way he looks. That's going to show up on the battlefield, I think, that self-confidence. But he looks really cool standing there. I'm like, Steve, I see what you see in Bucky. He looks great. He looks really cool. Steve looks okay. And you can see it, the importance of the characters, right? So, of course, Robert Downey Jr. is in the middle of it. Then you've got the other two Avengers right below him because their contracts aren't, you know, the two Chrises, their contracts aren't quite as strong. Black Widow, of course, front and center, looking nothing like Black Widow. And then Star-Lord and T'Challa. I love that they're, also in that second circle. I think you know, definitely worthy of that. So many Guardians made the poster too. That's amazing. And wow, look at Don Cheadle's spot. We're going to talk about Don Cheadle. I have a little bit of a problem with him still being in the movies. Although Scarlet Witch looks very cool up there, and I love that the two magic users are right there on the two, you know, the top two sides. I really want to see her show up in Doctor Strange too. Which for some reason no one's discussing Doctor Strange too. That movie made money. I don't understand why they're not considering making it. Or why it's not being discussed. Falcon, by the way, not a great spot for poor Falcon. And I wonder why Nebula is on the other side, far away from the other Guardians. But also, I like that Thanos only has two of the Infinity Stones in the poster. I think that's great. His glove is not complete. See the movie to see him complete his set. All right, very cool. Very nice poster. I think it's really pretty. It's going to look particularly nice when it's backlit at multiplexes. All right, so let's dive into this trailer. So we start out over Manhattan, and something's in the sky, you know, racing towards the city. And my theory is twofold. It's either Bruce Banner, who crashes into the, Doctor Strange's headquarters, or it's that circle, that glowing circle that shows up in Manhattan that, you know, is, I think, obviously going to be one of the earlier battles in the movie. Or maybe not. We'll see. So here we go. This is a very Russo brothers shot. They prefer a little bit of not as colorful color palette, which is weird considering the poster we just looked at, right? So there we go. Bruce Banner's back on Earth after crash landing. He's somehow hooked up again with Black Widow, and there's Rhodey being like, "I'm in this suit, I swear. Let me open my suit so that I can get some screen time." So they're looking up at it. That's the target, basically. And there we go. So he's got the Power Stone already, so the Nova Corps. Thanks a lot for doing nothing, Glenn Close. What are you doing up there? She's probably too busy styling her hair to protect the Infinity Stone. And he's just gotten the Space Stone, and he adds it to his collection. You know, I have to say, the Infinity Gauntlet's pretty well made. I love how it kind of like magnetizes in there. I'm like, that's very visually cool. So he's like, woohoo, two down. And I think that Loki just gave it to him, because we saw in the other trailer Loki handing up the Tesseract, being like, "Here you go, please don't kill me, or maybe my brother." He's striking some kind of deal, probably. And so Thanos adds it to the set, and we'll see the other side of that scene later in this trailer. So Gamora right now is like, "As long as I've known Thanos, he's wanted to destroy half the universe." And I like this. I like that they finally got some exposition in here. So Tony's like, "Tell me his name again, for me and the audience." I love that Tony's at the center of all these discussions, right? And so she's like, as you can see, she's going to be in just a minute, she's like, "Thanos." And I'm like, why didn't you bring this up earlier? I mean, she kind of brought it up earlier, but I'd be like, this is the first I'm hearing about the destroy half the world thing, Gamora. I think you would have maybe mentioned this to all of us, right? So we could have at least paid more attention to it. She's like, "Have you been watching the end credit sequences of your own damn movies?" I don't know. If I were the other Avengers, I'd be like, I would have preferred a little bit of a heads up on this. Thank you very much. The Avengers maybe need like a database, you know, just like the FBI and the CIA have like top 10 criminals in the world. Maybe they need to be a little more organized. I think you need to hire some administrative services, Avengers. Avengers Administrative Services. That'd be great. Well, that's what happens when you get rid of S.H.I.E.L.D. I guess that's the thing. You guys want to dismantle S.H.I.E.L.D.? Look what happens. Thanos is like, bureaucracy was my secret weapon all along, or lack of bureaucracy. So there he is in his armor. I'm glad he eventually ditches it. He doesn't rock the armor, in my opinion. So there's Peter Parker. How does nobody see it? He has like the worst kept secret in the world. So he puts on his mask, and they're like, "Hey, look, Spider-Man obviously switched clothes with Peter Parker." So look, I love this though. Oh, that's a gorgeous shot. Let's watch that again when he just skims the water. I mean, I'm sure it's partially because, you know, he has too much webbing. You know, he didn't measure it correctly. But it's a good example of how the Russos are very good visually and adding that little extra oomph to make a scene that much cooler. You know, you should always be trying to plus your scenes from a visual perspective. You're like, sure, he could just swing by, but what if his feet skim the water, creating a little wave? You're like, oh, I like it. Let's do it. And the visual effects department's like, did you see my list of my to-do list already? And they're like, add the water. And we're like, thank you. So there he goes. Oh, so beautiful. Now, here we go. I have to say, I don't know why New York has to always be under fire. So there, although Doctor Strange actually, as a New Yorker, I can tell you Doctor Strange lives right in the vicinity of that little circle that's popped up there. He lives right on the water's edge there. That's where Doctor Strange's building is. That's where his home is. I don't know. Did he move out of that nice apartment and he still lives now he lives in the village? But anyway, you can see in an interesting bit of serious perspective for a movie like this, The Freedom Tower, the new World Trade Center, is in the foreground of another real attack on New York City. And I don't know how I feel about that. I guess we have to move on. But, I mean, this is a comic book movie. Let's keep that kind of stuff out of it. Now, this is Tony. He's going after that circle. I don't know if it's coming in or Probably coming in because Tony has this ridiculous line. Tony embarrassed me here. Where Tony said, oh, the advantage we have is that he's coming to us. And I'm like, and as I said in my trailer reaction, I was like, that's not an advantage. You don't want to fight this war with the stakes this high on your home turf. Fight it over there. Like, Superman is always supposed to do it. Well, he's supposed to do it. He hasn't been doing it in the movies, which people feel is out of character. You're supposed to lead the big superhero battle away from the population. Not like, yes, he's coming to us in the middle of one of our big... No, actually, New York City is the biggest city... not in the world, actually. I believe Shanghai is the biggest city in the world. Shanghai has like 34 million people in it, and New York has 8. So that just goes to show you. That's why China has so much money at the box office. That's how many people are living there in one city. So I think it's ridiculous. I'd be like, we need to take this fight off world. And I believe they do. Some of the other shots that we're about to see, and they're in like some clear CGI setting. We've been told that's Titan, actually, Thanos' home world. So I guess they do take, maybe someone's like, this was a bad idea, Tony. We got to take this fight to him. So there he goes. I think, oh, look at that. Did you see how his armor upgraded? Oh, and he became like a chess piece. I'd be like, wow, Tony, you're becoming more robotic every day. That's really cool, though. Wow. Yeah, it adds on to the bottom of his feet. That's one of his blasters. His wings haven't popped out just yet. But he really did take off when that kicked in. That's amazing. I don't know how he doesn't melt his feet off. Very cool, though. And also, I have to say, his armor is so thin, I don't know how it can create... Because, you know, it's comic books. But, you know, sometimes I think they have to be careful not to overpower Tony. That it breaks, you know, as far as we're willing to go in giving them some leeway in terms of science. So he takes off. They're saying, we have what he wants, all these Infinity Stones. And, like, Vision's like... Doctor Strange is just wearing his. Mine's stuck in the middle of my forehead, and I'm pretty sure it's my life force. It's not looking good for poor Vision. And they're like, we're going to take him to Wakanda. So you can see, everybody's here. Some of you were very upset that T'Challa didn't have any lines here, but they played him up quite a bit in the other trailer. So I think it's time now to show that it's a group. So you can see, basically, Cap's team is back together again. As many of you are pointing out, where the heck is Ant-Man? He's like, I got my own movie this summer I gotta promote. But you got Vision, Wanda in the back there, Bruce Banner, a War Machine, Rhodey, and there's Falcon, and of course, Widow and Steve. I have to say, I'm a little upset that Rhodey is still around. And he's walking around with those ridiculous metal, you know, pants on so that he can just be like, nothing happened. And that's like, I think that's just Marvel in a nutshell. There are no consequences. You know, the guy fell out of the sky in Civil War, and here he is walking around just fine with some clunky pants on. I'm not a fan of it. I think that... you know, he's not even, you know, and, you know, there's a lot of talk about representation. Look at how wonderful a story Barbara Gordon was when she was confined to a wheelchair and became Oracle. What if she just put on special pants? In fact, she has some kind of implant now that allows her to go back to being Batgirl, and I'm really upset about that. I think it really, it lessens the ramifications of, I think that something that's very traumatic and should be real. So I don't like that Rhodey. I mean, I just don't like that he's walking around. I got a problem with it. By the way, who are these male soldiers? You know, we have the Dora Milaje. I believe I've been mispronouncing that. Apologies, ladies. Dora Milaje. They're, of course, protecting T'Challa, their king, as they're sworn to do. But you can see we now have these male soldiers. Where were they during the coup, by the way? Maybe T'Challa started. He's like, I think... No offense, ladies, but I think I need, you know, a bigger military force after I almost lost my country. So we now have two types of soldiers. I guess that's a nice idea from a marketing and merchandising perspective that anyone can fight for Wakanda. So, although the guys seem to have more armor. Now, at first I thought she was looking at something of the space stone, because that's blue, but it's actually Vision's face. Vision's face looks like a space stone. But I'm sure when he came off that ship, sure he's like, bring him to me. So here she is in her lab, and she is obviously doing something, working with Vision. Maybe she's trying to find a way to separate that Infinity Stone from his head, that he can still survive. And if anyone can do it, it's Shuri. I'm glad she's on the case. She looks very cool. She didn't get a line either. Now here are the... Guardians. Now, I love this interaction. This was great. I was a little nervous as to how this trio would interact, Star-Lord, Tony Stark, and Peter Parker. They're all very similar. So I thought that maybe they'd cancel each other out. But they found a way to make it work. I think it's hilarious. I think Chris Pratt's doing a great job the way he's like, your plan's great, except it's awful. But maybe if I did it, and then look at Robert, and I, oh, by the way, everybody loved Peter Parker's fluffy hair. Kind of looks like my hair today, so I liked it. I was like, ah, did you get a blowout too? I told you, someone's doing blowouts at Avengers Tower, and Peter Parker was like, can I get in on that? And it works for him. He looks great. And he also looks great in his new armor. That's some really nice, that's some sexy armor there. It's really, it's just lean and mean. I love it. And so I love his, he's just like, I'm having a great time. And I love the way Tony's listening to it. This is so much like what a business meeting is like. When you have two people who are peers having a serious disagreement but trying to be respectful of each other. And Robert Downey's reaction of like, wow, is like, that's like Star-Lord in a nutshell. Like, wow, you're a lot to deal with, man. You know, and, you know, his teammates call him on it, but, you know, they're all content to... you know, Star-Lord's the leader. They all follow him. This is the first time that Star-Lord is interacting with somebody who feels that he's at least his equal and perhaps his superior. So this is a handful for Tony to have to deal with. I think it's so funny. That's so great. Now here they are going into battle. Those are some cool cruisers. They're almost Star Wars-y like. Now look, so they're this is an interesting thing. So they're going into battle and they're like, this is taking place uncomfortably close to our capital city. It's like, this is tough luck. Let's see here. So Steve is with T'Challa, and there's Okoye behind them, it looks like. Now on the other vessel, we've got Black Widow, but then there's Bucky behind her, and look how weird this is. By the way, you'll notice that Bucky doesn't look at all. Well, Steve's not looking over at them either. I wonder what's happening. I wonder if they're going to have a romance between Captain America and Natasha. I'm not sure. It'll be interesting. You know, I feel if they want to shut down these Stucky rumors, they could easily have... either individual get a girlfriend, and we'll see if they actually decide to go there. But maybe those will, they have a camaraderie as, you know, two people who fight who have fought in, you know, the political arena, so to speak. But the thing that I wanted to point out here is that Bucky's hair isn't moving in the wind. I mean, either he's used a ton of hairspray before going into battle. He's like, my looks are important to me. But I don't. I think that's shocking that it's not moving at all. I think that's a real mistake on the VFX and just how they were shooting this. I'd be like, you gotta have that wind cannon hit Bucky behind her because it looks ridiculous. All right, so then you can see. I think I agree with everybody that this is probably Bruce Banner in the Hulkbuster armor for a shot that's coming up momentarily that makes me feel that way. Look who's flying behind him. That's so cool. Who is that? One of those people. Is obviously Falcon. He's easy to spot. Is that War Machine with him, maybe? Maybe. That's pretty cool. I love that. I love battles that take place on different planes. I think it's really cool. There's something interesting about this battle that we get to in just a moment. Now look at that cape action. Capes are going out of style in the MCU, but Doctor Strange, and I think this is Doctor Strange because of the collar. I think it's Doctor Strange. It might be Thor. I don't know, but that is a nice cape shot. That's a nice cape shot. They're really rocking the cape. I love the way it moves in the wind. It's very epic. And that seems to be, maybe that's Rocket Raccoon's POV. He's like, maybe he's like, I should get a cape. It's pretty nice. So Rocket Raccoon, not cracking a joke there. Lightning powers. Oh, I love them. I think this is such a great addition for Thor. And look, I don't think he has a weapon here. Yeah, I think he's just calling that thunder. Calling down the thunder. Bring down the thunder. It looks great. It makes him such a more visually interesting character. And there's Teen Groot. You put down the phone for this boy, right? Who doesn't love a good lightning storm? Look at that little branch growing on the back of him there. That's so cool. Now, I think this is Titan. Now, here we can see, boy, that is so CGI-y, by the way. I hope it's not done. Why couldn't they get an actual little kid and put green paint on her and have her hold a fake hand? I don't see why they're both CGI. It doesn't make any sense to me. But this is obviously Gamora's origin story, right? Black Widow's like, hey, Russo brothers, I thought I was your top female character. They're like, sorry, we're going to throw our attention behind Gamora. And I think Gamora could use it. I would like to see Gamora become a little more badass. She's supposed to be. By the way, did you see the costume, you know, the concept art that was originally done for her? I have to say, I like it a little bit better than the way she ended up. I know that it doesn't fit. The reason they said they didn't go with it is because it doesn't fit with the tone of the Guardians of the Galaxy movies. But I'd be like, make it fit. It looks so cool and amazing. All right, so anyway... He's like, I shall adopt you and turn you into a warrior. Now here, it's not looking so good for Thor with Thanos, and I agree. One of you tweeted me and said they're playing a shell game with which of the Marvel Trinity is going to die, and I think that totally seems to be the case. I still think it's going to be between Cap and Iron Man, and some of you say maybe both, and I can see that happening as well. Now here we go. The Black Order, our first shot at them. This is Thanos' hit crew. His best of his best, his adopted children, just like Gamora, who maybe he hoped one day would serve in his Black Order, but she ran away. So here we have the woman there is Proxima Midnight, and you can see actually, you know, Loki is their prisoner, as some of you guessed. I think he's just handed over the space stone here, the Tesseract, and you know, they're keeping their eye on him because Loki, of course, is very dangerous. Although I have to say, when you read about him, when you read his stories in the comics, he's a little more dangerous in the comics. He has a few more tricks up his sleeve, whereas here, I wouldn't be that worried about Loki. This Loki, I think, has proven not to be that creative. I mean, he has his moments, but he's not as dangerous as the comic book version, and I wish that he was. So anyway, she has a very cool weapon. You can see she has it drawn on him there. Now that's, again, Proxima Midnight. She's married to Corius Glaive, who is the guy with the hoodie on over there. He also has a weapon. But then Ebony Maw is he's like the Purple Man. Basically, he can control you through talking. And so he is his own weapon, and you'll see him again in a moment. He looks very cool. And then the muscle back there is, Cull Obsidian. They look pretty cool. I'm excited to see them in close-up. I'm actually the most disappointed in Proxima Midnight. I thought she would look more visually interesting. Maybe she does, but in this shot, she's a bit of a letdown. I have to say, Corius Glaive, that looks exactly like he does in the comics, and so does Ebony Maw. That's impressive. That's really, that's rare to see Marvel in particular translate to that degree. Yep, there it is, see? So he breaks down the Tesseract, and he's like, I'm gonna put this on my glove. Very cool. Now they have nice little editing here. Now obviously what's happening here is they're trying to break into the shield, the aliens that, you know, you saw them fly into it in the Black Panther movie to get into Wakanda. This is like the first line of defense at the borders of this nation. Although I never saw Killmonger have any problem getting through it, so I don't know what's going on there. We'll talk about this. There's another shot of it later on. This is very cool, though. I love seeing superheroes work together in team situations. So, as you can see, Doctor Strange is creating little things, Valerian style, little for Star-Lord to walk on. I think that's great. And then here, this shot is amazing. Do you see here? There's Star-Lord in the foreground, and there's Doctor Strange with his cape billowing in the wind, delivering some kind of magic blast. That looks just like a comic book. That really, you know, is so cool to me. I haven't felt that way watching a Marvel movie since the first Avengers, where I felt this was actually like watching a comic book come to life. It's very cool. So there's Star-Lord again. Seems to be some gravity situation. I am loving Wanda's hair. She looks great. Now there's Doctor Strange having a very bad day. He seems to be being tortured either for real or mentally. That does not look good. Wow, he's gonna have even more gray hair after that. Now there, oh, I'm so excited to see who does the voices for these characters. There's been a leak, but if Whoopi Goldberg is actually voicing one of these characters, I'm gonna be really surprised. Maybe it'll work, but I don't know. But Ebony Maw looks very cool. I love it. Now here, this is very interesting to me. Do you see these formations? This is old school battle formations. This went out a long time ago. This is how like they used to fight in the Middle Ages and with the Romans and also the British during the Revolutionary War. And one of the reasons that it went away is because as guerrilla warfare became more popular, you know, the American rebels learned it from the Native Americans, and obviously it was very successful. And this type of warfare is almost entirely, if not entirely, gone away. So I'm surprised to see that Wakanda would bring it back. I guess very few battles these days take place in an open field, and this harkens back to those earlier battles in that way. So I guess why not use the techniques that were used in that time period? But as someone who's interested in, you know, the history of military warfare and different battle strategies, I find this interesting. Okay, so there you can see, there's Bruce Banner. What's he doing in the back, man? I'd be like, why are you in the back? Get out there, you're the one wearing a giant Hulkbuster suit. But as you're gonna see momentarily, it's not helpful. Look, he's being taken down. And I suspect at this point, the Hulk will have to come out and break through and take care of these aliens. It's gonna be a great sequence. I can't wait. So there's Thanos monologuing. Although Tony looks like he has to listen to this. Look how his armor is really messed up. And you can see that it's trying to rebuild a little bit, but I don't know why it quite can't. It looks bad. And Robert Downey Jr. lets you know it's bad with his look on his face. I think this looks very powerful. So Thanos is like, I hope they remember you. And I'm like, we'll never forget you, Tony. And this is very nicely cut, the way it comes down when he jumps in and then his fist comes down on Steve. I don't know how Steve can hold him back. That's crazy to me. Maybe because he doesn't have all the Infinity Stones yet. I do like Steve's new hair. Really, that's very fashionable forward hair. I'm surprised a military person would have such amazing hair. And I don't know how he's going to keep it out of his face. All right. Now look at that. Thanos looks so much like Josh Brolin. It's crazy to me. Almost to the point where I'm like, I wish you just shot Josh Brolin in the makeup and then just digitally inserted him and made him bigger. You know, like the way, one of the few good things in A Wrinkle in Time was how they handled giant Oprah Winfrey. She was as big as Thanos in that movie in some scenes. And it was very believable. But they didn't do CGI Oprah, so I wish that they had kind of done the same thing here because you would get, an even better performance out of this character. But wow, and again, it looks so much like Josh Brolin. Why not just use Josh Brolin? Why do I need a digital version of him? Wow. Cap is not having a good day. I hope somebody helps him out. And so then they have the logo. Very slow logo. Infinity War. And then I like this exchange at the end. Look, that suit even looks great in the dark. Oh, look, it glows a little bit. That's great. It's got like a little bit nighttime setting. That's very cool. So he's like, I'm Peter Parker. I don't know why Peter Parker, at some point, it's like there's a fine line between adorable and too naive, right? It's like, don't lead with your actual name, buddy. Although he doesn't have his mask on, so. Oh, by the way, I think Benedict Cumberbatch, I don't know, his face looks a little funny. I don't know if maybe he had something done. I'm not sure. It looks a little pinched. I'm not quite sure why he doesn't look the same as he usually does. It's weird. I don't know. That's what distracts me a little bit with his lines. His face looks a little plasticky. That's what I would say. And there he is, swinging around. And he looks great. They're continuing to do like the Romita Spider-Man moves. Like that was one of the best things about the Amazing Spider-Man movies, which doesn't get enough credit for it. And that they really did, the movement of the character looked like it was ripped from the comics. He seems to be all alone out there. I don't see any other Avengers. But wow, his spider sense is certainly helping him navigate that mess. So yes, tickets are on sale, and I hear they're going very quickly, so make sure that you get them. I don't know if I would see it in 3D, though, by the way. The last couple of Marvel movies, they haven't showed them to the press in 3D, and I don't really know if they're necessary. But just get whatever tickets you can, and you can always change them later when additional showtimes go on sale closer to the date. But it looks like a lot of fun, and as I said in my trailer reaction, I'm really hoping for some legit consequences, because that's what we've been promised. And I'm going to be really disappointed if they worked so hard to convince us that they were going to deliver consequences this time and then didn't do it. So what do you think about the poster, about the trailer? I'm excited to hear your thoughts in detail down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.